एक्टर्स विद नो बैकग्राउंड ऑफ खान एंड कपूर डूइंग सिनेमा एंड दे आर एक्सेप्टेड बाय डायरेक्टर्स प्रोड्यूसर्स एंड ऑडियंसेस विच इज आई थिंक अ वेरी पॉजिटिव डिवेलपमेंट.
I'm familiar with your academic background, your interest in theater, very elaborate involvement in the world of theater, and then also your occasional dabbling in Bollywood, somewhat art cinema, also recently in web series you were seen. So it's very evident that you don many hats, but I always wondered, being an academic, a teacher in a college, which hat do you prefer personally?
I opted academics over other things. As a student, also when I was studying honors in English literature, and during my post graduation and subsequent MPhil work, I had this option of moving in several directions, but I decided for myself that this is the area I love the most. I enjoy the most. I like interacting. I like sharing, and then one can call it teaching also. I was working with a central government ministry job, so-called class one gazetted officer's job, more on the side of administration, and I resigned from Minority Affairs Ministry, got back into academics in a way that I was the visiting faculty for a little while. Then I got the job. I worked for 18 months, realized this is something which I don't wish to do, but did that because there were some financial implications. You see, opted back to university college job and worked there for 10 long years. Needless to say, that was not something which was a transit period. I was deeply, deeply, profoundly interested in something on those lines, wherein the kind of research which you do, the kind of learnings which you have in your life, you can share it with a younger lot. To add to this, the theater group of the college where I taught at Khalsa College was also an interesting area where you see learning about an author and his works could be used as a performance, not only for you to understand him or her, but also to share that knowledge with a larger cross-section of young people. And I humbly take the credit of developing a large corpus of campus theater work over the last, I should say, some 12, 13 years, through my personal involvement on one hand, and also curating a festival called ACT, Ateliers Campus Theater Festival, on the other, which was organized by Atelier Theater. So I was very happy dabbling between the college teaching and the kind of academic work I was doing at Atelier. But I think the developments from FYUP to CBCS kept me sort of quite dissatisfied with the kind of work we were doing. And I also realized that, you see, when still, you see, there is a stigma, not only in our society, but also in the space like an academic institution where you're teaching, that drama is an extracurricular activity still. And I was actually contesting this idea that this is not a kind of extracurricular, this is curricular, this is main, this is primary. But you see, so people who are sort of not happy, perhaps for whatsoever reasons, I do not know, with you, they, or maybe with your ideological positions and the way you sort of talk about what you believe in, they had problems with the students you work with. So within the college community at Khalsa College, Delhi University, Ankur was the society I worked for as a convener for 7 8 years, and with CBCS, which FYUP, we were also critiquing the politics behind CBCS, the politics behind FYUP, and not only in the classroom but also through a play. Quite likely, you see, you would become a problem for the authorities. And I was told about this concern. I should use the word concern here. I was told to also leave that space. That was a big blow as far as the kind of academics I believe in for that. So I decided, I mean, I had two options to look at. One is to carry on with that petty college politics of doing the way authorities want you to do. That means you go to the classroom, be a very good, nice teacher, teach your subject without engaging with the ideological implications of that subject. How can you teach Dalit literature without looking at the politics of Dalit? How can you look at talking about partition literature without looking at the politics of partition? How can you teach post-colonialism without looking at the politics of COCO? How can you teach world literature without looking at the politics which works? Indian cinema for an actor like me would not go beyond the idea of either a taxi driver, role of a taxi driver, or perhaps a very aggressive sardar who's pulling out the hand pump and saying, "Vaheguru Ji ka Khalsa, I'll kill you," all that stuff. And I thought they do not have characters for a person, for an actor like me, who wears certain kind of costumes, you see. And I decided not to get into it at that point of time. And I thought, college teaching is perhaps the right kind of space for me. One, you learn, and two, you share. So the learning and sharing was keeping me alive, and it was a very interesting, happy, long 10 years phase for me. And I think I did a lot of work from Manu Bhandari's Mahabhoj to Saadat Hasan Manto's Manto Rang, to Jean Anouilh's Antigone, to n number of Nukkad performances, from Dharm to TRP to a lot of other stuff with the college society at Khalsa College. And I thoroughly enjoyed myself. It was great being there in the classroom and outside classroom. And my colleagues were amazing. They gave me the subjects I always liked, from modern European drama to modern Indian drama to Sanskrit drama to partition literature to Dalit literature and so on and so forth.
When does Atelier theater comes into picture? It became almost a phenomenon after a while.
It was Dave in 2004 when I formally got it registered. I mean, it's a not-for-profit organization, Atelier Theatre Society. In 2002, I started working on a play called Goodbye Blue Sky. And when the script got completed, I realized that for any performance, you need to have this umbrella organization so that you can take permissions from DCP and Entertainment Tax Office, so that you can put up a ticket, or at least if you want to hire Delhi Auditorium, they ask for certain acha, which theater group are you from, etc. 2010 is the year when अटेलियर रिपर्टरी कंपनी, उसको प्यार से हम ARC बोलते हैं, आर्क, दैट केम इन टू पिक्चर. एंड देन वी डिसाइडेड दैट वील हैव एटलीस्ट 20 to 25 शोज ऑफ ईच प्रोडक्शन वील मेक, वन टू इंश्योर दैट वी रीच आउट टू लार्जर क्रॉस सेक्शन, टू वी एटलीस्ट रिकवर द कॉस्ट ऑफ द प्रोडक्शन. एंड दैट रियली वर्क. एंड फ्रॉम 2010 ऑनवर्ड्स, क्वाइट रिसेंटली इन 2017 2018, वी डिड अ नॉर्थ इंडिया टूर इन विच वी विजिटेड सम 11 डिफरेंट सिटीज इन नॉर्थ इंडिया, डिड सम 52 शोज. द एनुअल फेस्टिवल, इट्स कॉल्ड ACT, अटेलियर्स कैंपस थिएटर फेस्टिवल, which has not only enriched us as a theater company, but it has also managed to create a strong foundation and platforms for college theater groups. I mean, when I was in college, I realized that there were some handful of 3 to 4 colleges, 5 colleges practicing theater regularly. In last 2 decades, if you see, the number of colleges have increased. If my data is correct, in Act 12, which happened last year, there were 83 entries we received from Delhi University and colleges around Delhi NCR, which involves some polytechnics, IP University, Ambedkar University. JNU also has a theater group, and all colleges they have their own theater societies working annually to create one stage play, one street play. Earlier they used to feel अच्छा करेंगे कहाँ, now they know for sure that there is one platform which is called ACT. At least Delhi made it's going to give platform. So I think we are lucky enough that after 16 years of work now, we have a small center of arts which has our own performance space, which has our own rehearsal space, which also has a small performance cafe. I think this is what we had been able to manage in last. I go back to your question. I strongly feel that COVID-19's impact would definitely be seen on screen, on stage, in artworks in near future. Somebody was telling me they have created small, very short plays around the impact of COVID on arts, artists, and artistry, and they would like to produce it once the auditoriums would allow them to do. So, yeah, I think one would imagine that these things would become a part and parcel of our processes in the days, weeks, and months to come. There would be huge, huge change one can imagine post COVID, if there is anything like that. A few people also feel there would be nothing like post COVID. We have to live with it. I somehow, I don't know, I don't relate with that. I mean, living with COVID, is it like living with the other diseases we have? If that is the idea, then it's fine. Would it be normal? Would there be any vaccination? But then, with regard to audiences, there is a scare whether it's going to be, I mean, whether audiences would be scared to enter into a theater space. But I think that is also equally valid for cinema. That is also equally valid for other art spaces. To my mind, I think it's too early to decide that there would be no audiences and there would be fall of audiences. I can sort of conjecture of one thing, that there would be a lot of newness which one would see in a theater hall once we go back. What would that newness be like is something which only time would decide. As far as the kind of cinema I see around, it did not always inspire me for a lot of reasons. One, I did not see any kind of work which was challenging the norms, and which was also giving me space to think beyond the realm of the popular ways of thinking. And as an artist also, when I was looking at the kind of so-called popular cinema, it was more on the lines of how the established norms are, and if you slightly go outside those norms, then there are economic fallouts, and nobody wanted to take that risk. In the last 4-5 years, things have changed. I think these OTT platforms, for whatever they are doing, I mean, They have managed to slightly democratize the entire idea of filmmaking. That's the positive bit I see in the latest phenomenon of filmmaking, and if we would like to call it cinema, with its flip sides as well. Maybe we'll come to that slightly later. You would also see. You see, actors with no background of Khan and Kapoor doing cinema, and they are accepted
right.
by directors, producers, and audiences, which is, I think, a very positive development. There is also a kind of breaking of ice and breaking of stereotype, which is also happening as far as this new kind of cinema which is shaping up. And a lot of artists from the circuit where I operate, they are sort of going to cinema, doing their work, coming back to theater, doing their work. And there is a kind of symphony which they have created between theater and cinema.
Yes.
Earlier, it used to be the kind of trend where if you get into cinema, you only do cinema. Now I see a lot of not only young artists, but also senior artists dabbling between the two. And I did Margareta with a Straw. A lot of people around me thought that I'll shift my base to Mumbai and go there and work, etc., etc. In fact, a lot of people asked me, and they perhaps presume that I live in Mumbai. And when I tell them, no, I don't, I live in Delhi, there is a kind of element of surprise also as a reaction which I receive. I think that's the kind of perception also that if you are doing theater because you eventually want to get into cinema. For me, Dev, eventuality was and is theater. I don't want to flaunt it and brag about it, but in the past, I have preferred my theater shows over cinema shooting. And then I requested the director and producer, I would like to work in this film, but if you can shift, people shifted. They respected my commitment to the shows and they did the changes. Not because they did not have any option, but they respected that, you see, the actor is occupied with some theater work and then they have to make certain arrangements and realignment in order to bring things together. So I think that's the positive side. A lot of people from my theater group, they are into cinema, but I don't see that once they get into cinema, they would say bye-bye theater and they do not wish to come back. I think with the OTT, another thing happened is that this Indian cinema has also moved out from Bombay. Earlier, we used to always feel, agar cinema karna hai, toh you have to go to Mumbai. My understanding is the way things have changed in the last one decade with social media,
right.
with facilities to fly from one place to another, you can be anywhere. And if you are practicing your art really well, and if you fit the bill of what the cinema director or producer wants to be, then you are on. You don't have to shift your base. With my work in Delhi, I never wanted to shift my base. For one reason, that I live with my parents and I didn't want to leave my family. Number two, shifting base also means that you have to start from scratch. My primary work is theater. So if I put up a show, I know that I have some 2,000 people to invite. And out of those 2,000, maybe 200 would come. And you would have decent audience to run a show. In Mumbai, again, if you go, you need to start from scratch, create your audience, and then rebuild yourself. And a lot of actors in the past, unfortunately, when they got into cinema, perhaps they did not get time to come back. Or perhaps they wanted the theater to be a kind of springboard to get into cinema, which is not the case with me as far as my work is concerned. And it's a kind of general notion that cinema is the eventuality. I always contest that it's not eventuality. Theater was, theater is, then theater would be something which I wish to do for whatever life I have for the rest of my life. Cinema, if it comes and if I really like the work, then one can always think about it. I do not say no to it. If it's a great script, it is also taking you to a larger cross section of people, which is not possible in theater. The kind of range, the kind of power that medium has, but I do not want to get into the rut of doing a very stereotypic kind of character which the popular cinema imagines, and I politely say no to that work because I had been contesting for the same for the last 20 years or so. And I always felt that a kind of ethnic community I belong to with a turban on my head and beard.
Yes,
there are certain notions associated with this kind of character. So there was no category like the Sikh actor or the Sardar actor.
Uh-huh.
And I think with Breathe 2, suddenly I see casting directors putting up this advertisement looking for a Sikh actor. And I'm really happy to see that. Now there is at least some sort of recognition for that category. Earlier there was no category like that. Yeah. So not that actor is actor at the end of the day, but then you see, there was this complete rejection of the existence of this ethnic community. So they are either represented as I said earlier, as a kind of cab driver, taxi driver, or a comedian or a very aggressive guy. So beyond that, there was no range which was explored. I really enjoyed myself playing a germaphobe in Breed 2, and I think I was given complete liberty to play that. And,
wonderful job you've done.
Yeah, thank you. I enjoyed myself, and I tell you, had it not been the kind of liberty which I got there, I might not have performed the way I performed. I think I was playful, I was enjoying myself, and when I receive a call from Devendra Janpurji, who taught at National School of Drama, and he says, "You were effortless," and then I realized this is what I was attempting. And I think when your directors and producers, they allow you to do what you wish to, this happens, which is not the case with a lot of other theater, cinema directors with whom I had worked with in the past. So I think this is the change which I had witnessed in last 1 decade. Dev, I never wanted to go to Mumbai and become what they call it, you see, struggler. I mean, not that this word is problematic, but then I think one can read books, one can watch films, one can work on voice and speech, body, space, everything. And then if there is work which comes your way, you do it. Instead of sitting there, going to production houses, where they say, not fit, not fit, not fit. And you listen to that not fit for 1 lakh times. And then you say, unfortunately, a lot of actors who go to Mumbai, they do not read.
Yes.
Ask them, best padha, they do not read. And they say, I want to become an actor. I said, did you read Stanislavski? He said, no, I do not want to read. Then what do you want to do? I want to speak my line. But how would you speak your lines? And they say, you teach us. I can teach you, but then you need to read basics. At least you need to understand theory of the practice you want to get into.